Aloha kako. Hello, everyone. My name is Barrie Kealoha, and I am delighted to be a part of the Celebrating Our History Through the Arts Unity Through Diversity series. I want to start off by sending a huge thank you to Crystal MacArthur and to the Metuchen Edison Area Branch of the NAACP, plus the Middlesex County Arts and History Commission and the New Jersey Council on the Arts for making these programs possible. So, aloha and e komo mai. Welcome. So again, my name is Barrie Kealoha and I am Hawaiian. Okay, well, actually I am a lot of things. Like most people today of Hawaiian ancestry, we have a mixed heritage due to the many global influences that have come to the islands, whether to carve out a claim on the land or as indentured servants. Some of the most common ones are British, like me, Portuguese, also like me, Japanese, Chinese, Filipino. I'm extra fancy, so my family has thrown in a bit of Scandinavian and Native American for good measure. There are hardly any people today with solely Hawaiian ancestry, but the few who are have exclusive access to the island of Ni'ihau, which is the smallest island of the Hawaiian archipelago where the chickens outnumber the humans. You know what? I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm here tonight to share with you the immense love and pride I have in my Hawaiian ancestry. So though my whole heritage is mixed, I did grow up with a lot of Hawaiian traditions in my home. Hawaiian and pidgin words being thrown into everyday conversation, the food, the music, and most importantly, the aloha spirit. If nothing else, that is what I hope you take away from today's show. The aloha spirit is the basis of everything it means to be Hawaiian. It's even enshrined in Hawaiian law. I am so glad to have the opportunity to share this with you tonight because, well, there aren't a lot of Hawaiians in the tri-state area. Outside of Hawaii and small pockets of the West Coast that have larger Hawaiian populations, real Hawaiian culture is really underrepresented. I'm here tonight to not only share with you my love of the beautiful islands of my ancestors, but also to add my voice to a conversation that often excludes people like me. I want you watching tonight to look past what you think you know about Hawaii. What is easy? We are not coconut bras and tiki drinks and exotic hula girls, like whatever that is. We are so, so much more. Now, I am only a single representative and I can only speak to my own experiences, but I am proud of every part of who I am, and I am overjoyed to be able to share with you tonight my island heritage, all the way from the island of Oahu to the island of Manhattan. Now, you've probably heard the word ohana, which means family. In Hawaii, everyone is ohana. Everyone is your uncle and your auntie and your cousin. It's even a little weird to not refer to your close friends that way. But Hawaiians are part of an even broader ohana than that. We trace our ancestry back to ancient Polynesians who hailed from as far away as New Zealand. Over the several thousand years that our ancestors explored further and further across the Pacific, the language and the stories and the traditions evolved to become the distinctive cultures that they are today. But one thing inextricably connects us all, from New Zealand to the Marquesas to Hawaii to even as far as Easter Island, and that's the ocean. Now, I have always been drawn to the water, as you can see. So it's no surprise that I spent many years sailing the world while performing, singing and dancing on cruise ships, or why I ended up here on the island of Manhattan. The ocean is truly the great unifier. Speaking of the ocean, I'm sure that many of you have seen or know the Disney animated movie that came out in 2016, Moana. I was over the moon when I saw that Disney was going to be making a movie about a Polynesian princess. My inner five-year-old was absolutely freaking out the entire time. I genuinely started crying as soon as the opening credits started. True story. The Grammy award-winning song that came from the movie, How Far I'll Go, it really resonated with me, not just because of the message, but for the possibilities provided by sailing beyond the ocean's horizon. It resonated with me so much, in fact, that I recorded my own version of it with lyrics in English, which I grew up speaking, Spanish, a language that I learned, and Hawaiian, the language of my ancestors. Enjoy.
Been staring at the edge of the water long as I can remember, never really knowing why. I wish I could be the perfect daughter, but I come back to the water no matter how hard I try. Every turn I take, every trail I track, every path I make, every road leads back to the place I know, where I cannot go, where I long to be. See the line where the sky meets the sea, it calls me. No one knows how far it goes. If the wind in my sail on the sea stays behind me, one day I go, there's just no telling how far I'll go. Yo sé bien que todos en la isla son felices en su isla. Por designio todo es. Yo sé bien que todos en la isla cumplen bien sus papeles. El mío es rodar tal vez. Puedo liderar, darnos fuerza hoy y contenta estar, seguir mi actuación, mi voz interior, canto otra canción que está mal en mí. E a mai ka a ke pa mai ne mau kai kai, hiki ana ro, hika lipo lipo, kohu mea la ke hea mai ne.
Mahalo. Thank you. Huge thank you to Ryan Kiavekane for those Hawaiian lyrics. Thank you, Ryan. If you enjoyed that, you can head over to my website, barriekealoha.com, and you can download that song for free. It is my gift to you. Don't worry, I will put that link up again at the end of the show. So it probably bears mentioning why I sang a verse in Spanish, right? Now, I didn't grow up speaking Spanish, but I did learn it in school, I studied abroad, and eventually I became fluent. Plus, it didn't hurt that I grew up in Southern California, so I had plenty of opportunities to use it. So speaking Spanish has provided me with countless opportunities, not the least of which is opening doors to learn about so many other cultures. In 2016, I had the immense pleasure of performing in the European premiere of a Spanish language version of the opera Carmen by Bizet. It was set in 1950s Cuba. Many of the cast were from Cuba, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, and in speaking to them, I was delighted to find out that many aspects of Caribbean culture are very similar to Hawaiian. There's something about living on an island that forces you to be aware of the natural beauty around you, the delicate balance of nature and humanity, and the importance of community, and just generally taking life at a more relaxed pace. You've probably heard the phrase before, being on island time. Plus, we are all obsessed with anything made out of guava. Like, it's legitimately a thing. In honor of this connection and to celebrate the fact that maybe Caribeños and Hawaiians have a lot more in common than we think, one of my very dear Cuban friends dubbed me with the nickname La Isleña, which literally means island girl. It's a title that I wear with pride. This sense of community and compassion is the central idea to what we call the Aloha Spirit. There's a reason why Hawaii is called the Aloha State, and it's not just a cute little word that we toss around to put on keychains and t-shirts. Okay, we definitely put it on t-shirts. Aloha isn't just hello and goodbye, it's a way of life. The word ha actually refers to breath, and alo comes from an idea kind of close to the meaning of presence. So aloha actually refers to a common breath, a breath that we share. Therefore, you know, we are connected. In that way, aloha is a little bit more similar to a word like namaste. And I think that that is such a beautiful way to make a greeting. It's for that same reason that aloha also means love, like my name, Ke Aloha, which means beloved one. Someone who lives aloha, meaning to live with that sense of respect for the land and for the ohana, is a powerful force. To live aloha is to be full of good mana, which is like an inner power, kind of similar to chi. It's your energy, it's your soul. And not many people had more mana than this guy. And I'm not just talking about the fact that he was one big brother. This is the legendary Hawaiian musician and activist Israel Kamakawiwo Ole, also known as Iz. He was a prolific artist and well known in Hawaii before he skyrocketed to international fame with his beautiful, simple cover of Somewhere Over the Rainbow and What a Wonderful World, which he recorded in one take at like 3 o'clock in the morning, overcome with inspiration or maybe a burst of mana. Sadly, he passed away 4 years after that song was released, but his message of love and wonder is a lasting legacy.
Clouds are far behind me, where trouble melts like lemon drops high above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find me, oh, somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly. And the dream that you dare to, oh why can't I, will I see trees of green, red roses too, I'll watch them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Well, I see skies of blue and I see clouds of white, the brightness of day highlight the dark, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow So pretty in the sky are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry and I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than we'll know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Someday I'll wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where trouble melts like lemon drops high above the chimney tops. That's where you'll find me, oh, somewhere over the rainbow, way up high. And the dream that you dare to, oh why can't I oh,
isn't that beautiful? Oh, I love that song. Though that song was definitely the most famous song that he recorded, Iz was a well-established artist in Hawaii and recorded a ton of music and is still an inspiration for many modern Hawaiian artists. Much of Iz's music was a celebration of the sheer beauty of Hawaii and the love that its people have for the land. The connection to the land goes well beyond just environmental protections and Instagram-worthy sunsets, although that's definitely a big part of it too. The land is a living, breathing thing. It is sacred, like an extension of the soul, which is why any destruction to the land is felt as destruction to oneself. There's an old saying in Hawaii, "Na na ika kumu," which means look to the source. It is a guiding principle about how to recenter yourself when you're feeling out of balance. One of the things I love most about this saying is right there in the word kumu. Now, the word doesn't just mean source. It has a ton of meanings, like so many words in Hawaiian do. It means roots, it means purpose, it means foundation, and it even means teacher. When I taught Moana Jr. to a bunch of theater kids in Houston over Zoom this summer, I had them all call me Kumu Kealoha, which just made my heart soar. Hawaiians look to their roots for guidance, and our roots, they go very deep into the land. The land reminds us that we are a part of it as much as it is a part of us. The land should be treated with as much care as we treat ourselves. So it's easy to see why so many Hawaiian musicians and storytellers stress environmental activism in their art, right? Now, you may have heard or seen protests on Mauna Kea, the highest peak on the islands and also one of the most sacred places to Hawaiians, kind of like the Mount Olympus of Hawaiian culture. A research company has been trying to mount a telescope measuring almost 100 feet on top of the mountain for over 10 years now. And activists and scientists from all over Hawaii and the world have come together to protect the mountain. When you understand the connection between the land and the people, it's easy to see why the fight for preservation is so important.
There's no other place quite like it in the world, my beautiful Hawaii. There's no other place quite like it in the world, my beautiful Hawaii. And shine, it's the start of a brand new day. Oh, look It's like it in the world. Out of the ocean, my home is a precious pearl. My beautiful Hawaii. You'll never find another paradise like mine. I'm blessed to live here in Hawaii. The weather's right, we're living off the sweetest life. My beautiful Hawaii. Valleys you can't compare. We throw a shaka to the brothers and the sisters that we see. Ooh, yeah. We live aloha and share it with the ones we meet. My beautiful Hawaii. You'll never find another paradise like mine. See the beauty coming from Waiheke all the way to Nanakuli. Collaboration that none can divide. Spreading aloha to unify. Sweet kind of music on this tropical scene. Loving everything in between. Taking care of each other. Dance how we're supposed to be. No matter who be by your side. We are all family. My beautiful Hawaii. Find another paradise like mine. I'm blessed to live here in Hawaii. The weather's right, we're living up the sweetest life. Oh yeah, my beautiful Hawaii.
I'm going to shift the energy a little bit now and take you to a completely different place.
My kitchen. Hawaiian cuisine has been gaining traction on the mainland and all around the world for a while now, from seared ahi tuna steaks to Dole Whip soft serve at Disney parks to poke bowls. Food is a huge part of Hawaiian culture, and it's one major way that Hawaiians build community. Now, if I was doing this right, I'd invite you all over and we'd go out back and dig an emu or a barbecue pit, and we'd line it with hot rocks and tea leaves where we can put a whole pig that can slow cook for hours and hours to become pua kalua, which is sort of like Hawaiian carnitas. Unfortunately, I am pretty sure the city of New York would not be thrilled with me roasting a whole pig in the middle of Inwood Park. So instead, I'd like to introduce you to a more user-friendly but still very Hawaiian food. Spam! Not what you were expecting, right? Spam was not invented in Hawaii, but Hawaiians consume more spam per capita than anywhere else in the world, and it is absolutely everywhere on the islands. It is also a perfect marriage of everything that modern Hawaii has become, which is a true melting pot of cultures and histories. Spam is short for spiced ham, and it was created in 1937 as a way to use pork shoulder, which was not a very popular cut at the time, but it gained notoriety with American soldiers in World War II who received spam in their rations since it kept for a very long time. This is where the nickname Special Army Meat came from.
With so many soldiers stationed on Hawaii after Pearl Harbor, and because spam was cheap and Native Hawaiians had been pushed into poverty by the loss of their land and a ban on making traditional foods like poi,
spam slowly became incorporated into local cuisines, and it got a makeover depending on which culture got a hold of it. So spam is now served at Burger King's and McDonald's. There's a spam festival on Oahu called the Waikiki Spam Jam. And there are even sponsored spam cooking competitions held throughout the country at local and state fairs, which my own mother has won on multiple occasions. My mom spent much of her childhood in Hawaii and has leveraged her love of Hawaiian cuisine to win an absurd number of ribbons at the Los Angeles County Fair and the California State Fair. But one of her proudest accomplishments is being the reigning spam queen. Her first win was with a spam kulibiak, and I can tell you, I've had it a bunch of times, it is actually delicious. So what can I say? A love of spam is in my blood. One thing that you can find absolutely anywhere on the islands is a salty, savory, slightly sweet, very satisfying snack called spam musubi, which I am going to make for you today. It was created by Hawaiian Japanese Americans who adapted onigiri, which is like a sushi recipe, to include this king of the canned meats. Here we go.
Hilo to Hana or Honolulu, all Hawaiians know the tasty treat, salty, sweet delight. When it's that spam musubi time, yep. Hold tight. Dash of food, a cocky wanna snack food, mama. Spam on rice, it's very nice. Hold tight. Dash of food, a cocky wanna snack food, mama. Spam on rice, it's very nice. I like guava mangoes too. Shave ice will cool you when it's hot. But when I need a pick-me-up, spam musubi hits the spot. What? Hold tight. Dash of futakaki wanna snack food, mama. Spam on rice, it's very nice. Riyapara, ba-da-ba-da-ba-da-da. I like guavas, mangoes too. But when I need a pick-me-up, musubi hits the spot. What? Hold tight. Dash of foodie cocky, wanna snack food, mama. Spam on rice.
Spam, wonderful spam. Oh, it's lovely spam. Come on.
Hold tight. Want a snack food, oh mama. Spam on rice, it's so nice.
Woo! Huge thank you to my dear friends Anne-Marie Rosano and Carly Kincannon of the musical vintage vocal trio America's Sweethearts for singing that song with me. And a huge thank you to Carly as well, who did the beautiful arrangements of that song, which was originally a hit for the Andrews Sisters with slightly different lyrics. I made up the lyrics for this song, so I hope you enjoyed that. Did you recognize any of the spam jingles in the song? One of them was from the 1930s with Artie Shaw and his orchestra that was broadcast on the radio. Another one was from the 1980s, so depending on when you were born, you might recognize one or the other. And the last one in there was not a jingle at all. It was actually from a sketch by Monty Python. So a little something for everybody there. So the presence of American servicemen in Hawaii during World War II not just brought spam to the islands, but it brought Hawaii into the forefront of mainland culture as well. This turned into the Hawaiiana craze of the 1950s. Think tiki drinks, aloha shirts, canned pineapple on everything. And unfortunately, a ton of really problematic cultural appropriation as well. There was a song that the Andrews sisters recorded. This one stands out to me in particular, called Hula Baluau. And it was filmed for a movie where they were surrounded by a bunch of white women wearing plastic grass skirts. And it's a lot. Anyway, the repercussions of this Hawaiiana craze still persist today, and all too often. When I tell somebody that I am Hawaiian, I get asked to bust out my coconut bra and do a little hula for them. Or worse, I'll get asked if I am from the island of Kamanawanaleu. Seriously, it still happens to this day in 2020. It's frustrating to deal with that, but it genuinely just makes me really sad to think that that is all Hawaiian culture has been reduced to for a lot of people, not just Americans. Which is partly why I am so pleased to be able to share my show with you all today and to have the chance to dig a little bit deeper. So one big thing that came out of this Hawaiiana craze of the 1950s, besides Hawaii's statehood in 1959, was the popularity of surfing, due in no small part to this legend. Awe, so handsome. Duke Paua Kahina Mokoe Hulikohoa Kahanamoku, known simply as Duke, was a five-time Olympic swimming champion. He's regarded as the father of surfing, and he's responsible for making the sport world famous. And frankly, with him carving waves on a massive 16-foot traditionally designed surfboard with a face like that, it's no surprise. His statue stands on Waikiki Beach, which is where he grew up surfing as a child. And it's tradition to leave a lei on his statue when you visit. So the next time you're out there, make sure to say hi to Duke and bring a lei. Surfing was once the exclusive sport of Hawaiian royalty, but it has since spread worldwide, even making it into a Disney movie. I was so blown away the first time that I saw the movie Lilo and Stitch, not just because it was set in Hawaii, but the song Hawaiian Roller Coaster Ride was such a wonderful blend of traditional Hawaiian music and classic Disney music. It made me feel so seen. Again, my inner five-year-old was freaking out. And it also didn't hurt that my name is mentioned within the first couple lyrics of the song. You'll hear Aloha Aloha'e, Anuake Aloha'e. So I had to include it in my show tonight. So please enjoy Hawaiian Roller Coaster Ride.
Aloha Aloha'e, Anuake Aloha'e,
Anuake Aloha'e,
Aloha Aloha'e,
Aloha Aloha'e,
Anuake Aloha'e,
Anuake Aloha'e.
There's no place I'd rather be
than on my surfboard out at sea,
lingering in the ocean blue.
And if I had one wish come true,
I'd surf till the sun sets beyond the horizon.
Avikiviki my lohilo, ilave my ikopapahe nalu,
flying by on a Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
Viki viki mai lohi lohi,
lave mai ikopapahe nalu,
piina na nalu la la halaha,
oka moa na hanu panupa,
la 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 ikala hana hana,
meke kai hoi ni kapu eone,
hele hele mai kako e,
Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
There's no place I'd rather be
than on the seashore, dry, wet, free.
On golden sand is where I lay,
and if I only had my way,
I'd play till the sun sets beyond the horizon.
It's time to try the Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
Hang loose, hang ten, how's a chicka shaka?
No worry, no fear, ain't no biggie prana.
Cutting in, cutting off, cutting back, cutting out, front side, back side, goofy footed, wipe out.
Let's get jumping, surf's up and pumping, coasting with the motion of the ocean. Whirlpool swirling, cascading, twirling, Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
rather be.
Bet on my surfboard out at sea,
lingering in the ocean blue.
And if I had one wish come true,
I'd surf till the sun sets beyond the horizon.
Abikibiki, my love, you know,
he love in my eco papa hit in the
moon. Flying by on the Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
Yeah!
Biki biki, my lucky lucky, love it, my eco papa hit in the moon. Biki na 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 lula la ha la ha, o kamo ana hanu panupa. La la la, ika la ha na ha na, meke kai hoi ne kapu e one. Hele hele, my kaku e, Hawaiian roller coaster ride.
So tonight I've shared with you a whole bunch of facets of Hawaiian culture that makes us what we are. You've learned a little bit of the olelo, the language, the music, the food, the land, surfing. But there's one big thing that I have missed, and that is dance. I am talking, of course, about hula. Hula is uniquely Hawaiian, but telling stories through dance is a tradition that is shared by many, many cultures all over the world. It's important not to confuse hula with the fire dances of Samoa, the rapid fire hip shaking of the Tahitian Otea, or the spine-tingling beauty of the Maori haka, even though we all do share common ancestry. Hula in Hawaii takes many forms, from the traditional hula kahiko, which is my personal favorite, to the looser, more modern hula awana, but it is all a way to connect with each other, to connect with our ancestors, and to connect with nature. So in that way, it's a way to worship. As such, hula was banned in 1830 because European Christian colonizers deemed it a heathen practice. Hula had to be practiced in secret. It would be over 100 years before hula was allowed back into state celebrations, and another 50 years after that before Hawaiian language was allowed to be taught in schools. As hula went, so did the rest of the population. As Europeans gained strength on the islands, the mere fact of being Hawaiian became shameful. It became something you had to hide. And serious segregation practices were put into place to oppress the native population. Never heard that story before, right? This attempt to downplay one's Hawaiian-ness had a direct impact on my own family. This is an excerpt from my own grandfather's birth certificate. His mother, my Gigi, was required to state their ethnicity on the certificate, which is something that white citizens did not have to do. Gigi, whose Hawaiian name was Ku'ule, did not give my grandfather a Hawaiian name to not draw attention to his Hawaiianness. Even my mother and her siblings did not get Hawaiian names. It wasn't until my generation that being Hawaiian had finally come full circle and became something to be celebrated, not only privately with family traditions, but by passing on the love of our ancestry in the names of the next generation. So now, my family carries with pride our Hawaiian names. Kealoha, me, Ku'ule, Noelani, Leilani, Maile, Keoni, Kalani, Makena, and Kalea. Speaking of my ohana, if you find yourself in Honolulu at any time in the future, you can make a visit to Waldron Park near downtown and say hi to my great-great-grandmother, Mother Waldron, after whom the park is named. She was a notable philanthropist on the islands, and I'm very proud to call her my ancestor. Though we are now able to fully celebrate our ancestry, we cannot forget our history. The Kingdom of Hawaii was overthrown by the American government in 1893, despite the incredible strength and resilience of the last monarch of Hawaii and a woman that I personally admire greatly, Queen Liliuokalani. She led the islands with strength, grace, and dignity until the very end. She was also an accomplished musician and poet, and she wrote what is perhaps the most famous and popular song in all of Hawaii, which is Aloha Oe. And while the lyrics speak about two lovers who have to say goodbye to each other, Liliuokalani wrote it with her islands in mind, saying goodbye to the world that they knew as a kingdom governed by its people, to a territory governed by outsiders. It is heartbreaking, but it also stands as an anthem of solidarity for Hawaiians everywhere. I'd love to share her words with you tonight through the sacred art of hula. You'll see that each gesture has meaning, from the pua to aloha, meaning love. I haven't danced in many years, full disclosure. I am no expert, but this is very special to me, so I wanted to share it with you tonight. And I think tonight is a special occasion. So enjoy Aloha Oi. Thank you all so much for tuning in to Island Girl tonight. I hope that you enjoyed yourselves and maybe learned a little something along the way. So once again, I want to send out a huge mahalo, huge thank you to Crystal MacArthur, the Metuchen Edison Area Branch of the NAACP, the Middlesex County Arts and History Commission, and the New Jersey Council on the Arts for bringing me on tonight. If you would like to reach out to me and follow me on social media, I would love that. I am on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram as Barrie Kealoha, at Barrie Kealoha, and on my website, barriekealoha.com, which is where you can download my English, Spanish, Hawaiian version of How Far I'll Go for free. I'd love to connect with you all and hear what you thought of tonight's show, or even if you just want to tell me your own stories of Hawaii. I never don't want to hear about Hawaii, so feel free to reach out and contact me. I'd like to leave you tonight with one last song and with what I hope will be a blessing that you can take with you tonight and carry with you into the future. I'm sure you'll recognize the song. It was a huge classical crossover hit, originally recorded in English and Italian, but tonight we're going to give it a little Hawaiian twist. It speaks of a better world full of harmony and love and compassion. So what better send-off than that, right? This song makes me think also of a really beautiful Hawaiian proverb that I think is very important at any time, but is certainly extra pertinent in the world in which we find ourselves today. And it's something that I want you to take with you. Malama kehaki I kehaki, which means take care of one another. All right? I wish you all the best, and I hope that you will continue to hold the spirit of aloha in your hearts, no matter where your ocean takes you. So, from my island of Manhattan to your own island, a hui ho. Until next time.
I pray you'll be alright and watch us where we go and help us to be wise in times when we